Yes, my name is Jens Harning. I'm from Copenhagen, which makes me almost so a local artist here. The topic of the seminar, you know, art and somehow how and public space, I have two relations to that topic. The one is my practice as an artist, where I have been doing pieces, in public space for the last 20 years. And then for 3 years, I was working as an artist representative in the Danish Art Council for Art and Public Space. And somehow I I must say that these 3 years working for the Minister of Culture in Denmark with these public commissions has means that I'm actually quite disillusioned when it comes to what is possible in public space and how it should be treated and how the what frames can make some relevant support or can support some art activities in public space. The mail I got first, I got invited to participate as a practicing artist and just about my related to my practice. And suddenly, with the correspondence with the organization here, I have the feeling that it becomes more and more about that I should come up with a overall statement about public space, you know, or just like how art meets public space, and. As my reply to that invitation or the openness of the invitation, I have decided to insist on that I'm a visual artist, and instead of maybe coming up with a big chromed solution for things, I will just show some of the works I have done the last 20 years. So I have selected something approximately 10 pieces from the last 20 years, which is some of the activities I have done mainly in public space. Then I push here, and then this is the first one. This is like 20 years ago. It's in Oslo. It's a square called Grønlandstorg, and the piece is called Turkish Jokes. And what I have done here is that I have made a recording of jokes in my local pizzeria in Denmark, you know. And then I have on this square, I have put on this speaker, which is then broadcasting jokes in Turkish. So every 15 minutes, and somehow it's. It's in a such a very strange way addressing the Turkish community of Oslo, but it's also just making. A confusion about, you know, the authority of language and who is in charge of what, you know, like this square suddenly became like, you know, the meeting point of Philippine taxi drivers, not because they understood Turkish, but just because they felt kind of comfy with the situation of a foreign language. Here's another project from Copenhagen, which is called Arabic Jokes. And that's a poster campaign I made for an area of Copenhagen called Vesterbro, which is so the behind the central station, prostitution and foreigner area one of the foreigner areas of Copenhagen. And the poster is combining three jokes in Arabic and a pin-up girl taking from a local, boulevard paper. Then this boulevard paper has—it's called Ekstrabladet, and has a certain—it's very so like iconic Danish, where you have like the sun in Britain. You have so very very professional models, but this paper is insisting on having Danish girl amateur pictures, having the concept of a written concept behind which is called the daughter of the guy next door. So it's a very naturalistic, you know, like so very so. Scandinavian, liberal, free pornography, I don't know what. So it's a very nationalistic phenomenon, and then put up against these three jokes in Arabic. Then there's a piece here which is actually not in public space, with a piece I did in Holland, in Middelburg, where I moved an existing Turkish sweatshop or sewing factory into a Kunsthalle. And somehow, I mean, I don't know, like or in the works I do, it on my understanding of the divergence between, you know, like the institution or the Kunsthalle, the museum, the gallery, and the public spaces. I mean, sometimes it's very difficult for me to say that it's significantly different, you know. So somehow the way I look at the gallery or the exhibition space is actually more like another public space, or a public space with other implications, you know, than being on the street, you know. So I took in this one just to show her, and then they just like continue with their normal schedule there. So I choose like 10 pieces out of 20 years. So that I have done other how do you say, productionalized or placed other institution inside art institutions and so on. Yeah? And me and some of the workers in front of the building. Yeah? And here's a piece from Bienn, Switzerland, and the piece is called Foreigners Free. Yeah? And it's a public swimming pool, and in the public swimming pool, I have made an extension of the entrance board, so you have normal citizens, like 8 francs, and then you have students 4 francs, and then you as in the very end, you have like that foreigners is getting into the public swimming pool for free. Yeah? And somehow I was interested in this moment of, I mean, like that to I mean, every time we try to be friendly to others, we always do it in a very sort of diplomatic level. We can sit next to each other in the subway, and you know, like it's nice, and maybe you know, like just you can have a cup of coffee here and so on. And somehow I was interested in making the awareness of the cultural mix of Switzerland present in a place where the human body was very present. You know, I mean, people go to the swimming pool, they get naked, you know, like they see each other naked and so on. And somehow, the fully consequence of integrating others is also that they get kids together, you know. So somehow trying to move this, into a place where there was where the body was very present. What comes next? Then this is a piece. Then I've done a lot of swapping pieces, where I'm swapping, elements between institutions and outside, and also from street to street. This is a piece for Kassel in Germany, and the piece is called Kassel Hanoi Light Bulb Exchange. And what I have done, I have swapped the light bulbs of these street lamps in Hanoi with the light bulbs of these street lamps in Kassel. And what you see is actually completely nothing, because the light bulbs is exactly the same. But somehow I was aiming for making a statement, or like or if you want, more like a monument or a memorial related to the relationship between Vietnam and Germany. And the story between Vietnam and Germany is that DDR or East Germany were partners with Vietnam until Germany got reunited. So you had like that a lot of Vietnamese will come to Germany either to study or to work as contract workers in the factories. And then somehow also trying to make a piece which is at the same time, it's financed on German money, it's happening here like in Germany and in Vietnam at the same time. What comes next? Okay, yeah. Then actually, relate to that there was some critique of that, or some review, or I don't know what you call it. Somebody was writing related to this piece with the light and Vietnam. Then they were writing, you know, okay, the perfect match, you know, like the light bulbs are the same, you know. And I got really pissed off, because even though I tried to make it very subtle and discreet, I was trying to talk about a conflict where a lot of of Vietnamese citizens actually lost their possibility to stay in Germany, you know. So as a reply to that one, I made a piece for ICA in London, which was called Redistribution London Karachi. Yeah? And what I did was that I took the chairs of this public cafe of the Culture Institute. It's a museum, or it's a Kunsthalle, and it's a concert place and cinema and everything at the same time, ICA in London. And then I took all these seats from their public cafe and shipped them to Karachi, Pakistan, where they were then just dumped on the street so people could just take them. Interesting about the objects here, like these chairs are actually first edition designer chairs, I think from, I don't know, like 50s or whatever. But I was told that they cost something like, you know, 100, 120 euros, you know, on eBay, you know, like because they're first edition. And when they arrived in Karachi, Pakistan, you know, like they had, people told me that they would be sold like on the market for half a euro, you know. First of all, because they were worn out and old, and also because they found them super ugly because they were white, you know, like, so, I mean, in Pakistan, plastic chairs are red or yellow or green, not white ones, huh? So. Then suddenly, no, all this writing, nah, just whatever, yeah. Then here's a piece I did for an area called Leidserijn, which is outside Utrecht in the Netherlands. And that's one of the only permanent pieces I made. It actually grew out of a temporary situation, and it is such an official state road sign, you know, made by the road authorities of the Netherlands, stating that when you pass here, you have 5,012 kilometers to Afghanistan if you take the highways. And it's, officially the piece is still there. I'm not sure it's still there, but it's owned by the city of Utrecht today. Yeah? And here's another piece, which is called Arabic Joke, and which was made for Creative Times in New York. And it's basically, it's the same strategy as the other joke works. Here's just like, one joke, and then, nicely designed, and just so, yeah, just, yeah. And then here comes another piece I did for a biennial in Thessaloniki in Greece. And the piece is called Albanian Pigeons. Eh? And Albanian is just right next to Greece, you know. So you have, like, in Thessaloniki, you have this thing that you have Albanians. They will be waiting at the central station to get picked up. Then you can go, if you want your house painted or some garden work, you can go and pick them up. Eh? But the thing is that Albania is out at that moment is outside EU, you know, like so it's totally not prohibited to import animals from a non-EU country to a EU country. So what I did was just like that, with the help from some people, we smuggled in 30 pigeons, and then these pigeons were freed on this square in Thessaloniki, which means that ever since this day, the population of the pigeons of Thessaloniki will become a little more Albanian. Eh? So, and this is, I mean, but I mean, like, of course, it's very difficult to judge which ones are, you know, like, you know, Albanians and which ones are Greek, you know. So, here's another piece I did a few years ago in outside Copenhagen. And the piece is called Reducing Europe by 1 cubic meter. Huh? And what I did was that I dug this hole one time 1 meter, you know, and filled it into these crates, which were later on shipped off to Nigeria and Africa. Huh? Then somehow I had the possibility to, I mean, like... you need some address if you need to send somebody something. So I actually sent it to some Kunsthalle where I had an exhibition earlier, you know. And then I just told them, then it was stocked in the harbor there in Nigeria, and they were phoned up and said, what about this delivery? And they just said, they phoned me and I said, just say you have nothing to do with it, you don't know. They have to contact me, you know. And suddenly, after a month of these crates standing, then suddenly they disappeared, you know. And I somehow hope that these, I mean, like, that that somebody just empty out the crates, and so the soil of the crates just, I mean, to use the crates, you know, like so. So somehow, I mean, the whole idea is this, to make one continent bigger and another smaller, you know, so reducing Europe and then making Africa a little bigger. Then, I mean, then some of my works actually, I mean, it's difficult to talk about the permanency of such a work. I mean, like, Africa is still bigger than Europe, you know, like, because of this peace. But, I mean, and like, you know, and some of my works, like the Afghanistan sign is supposed to stand there, but I mean, there has also been other pieces where it's a little difficult to say, you know, if they're permanent or not, you know. But here's one of the only sort of really permanent monuments I have, which is in Warsaw, and the piece is called Brodno, and Brodno is... It's actually it's the name of a certain housing area of Warsaw, eh? And the housing areas you can see here in the background it's actually so tower blocks from the 70s and building up such a utopian perfect city for the socialist workers, you know. So you have this is such a big central park, and then around you have these tower blocks, and I think there's 600,000 people living there or something like that. So it's huge. And then somehow I had this idea, you know, like in a way it's. You could see that this is another Hollywood sign, eh? But it's a Hollywood sign very much celebrating, you know, like the handwork or the labor of the hand and the bricklaying and so on. Eh? So somehow try to, how do you say, basically make a new monument and then which is giving some . And somehow I don't know, like it's I don't know, maybe it's because I'm getting old and harmless, but I mean, like so maybe it's my only so really beloved piece, and I don't know, but I think it's still. I mean, also these pictures is just some pictures I just found on the net, you know, like just like from people somehow, having the life with this piece. Eh? So 2 minutes. Okay, that's it. What to say in 2 minutes? No, it's... Maybe, could I be the one where you can put a question? Is that a question from somebody?
Welcome to... We take the questions afterwards.
Okay, yeah.
4 minutes for questions in there.
Yeah, but we can... That's 1 minute. Okay, so we stop here. Okay, thank you.